Hey guys, welcome to Bandy Hacks. My name is Hoki.
And my name is Sam.
And today we'll be walking you through our open source workshop where we'll cover the basics of open source contribution and version control with Git. So I'm sure you're all familiar with this Chrome Dyna game that pops up when your Wi-Fi is down. Then today we're going to make our own version of this game for our workshop. By the end of this workshop, you'll know how to use GitHub and seamlessly collaborate with your team during this hackathon and beyond.
So before we move any further, let's discuss what is open source. So open source describes any software that is free and available for anyone to use and to edit and to contribute to. So the source code is available for you. You can take it down from anywhere. All of it is free and out there. You can edit it, you can do whatever you want with it, and you can make your own changes and potentially put them back into the code base for everyone else to use. So some good examples of very famous open source projects are Linux, which is an operating system, TensorFlow, which is one of the most popular machine learning frameworks out there right now, and Python, which is arguably one of the most popular programming languages in the world.
Now let's move on to the topic of version control. So version control is a system that tracks changes and records previous or multiple states over time. So for example, if you think of Google Docs and remember how you make edits over time, you know that you can always revert back to a previous version of that document by clicking on the See Revision History button on top. So that's an example of version control.
So why would we want to use version control? First of all, version control acts as a kind of safety net. So in case, let's say you are working on a bug, or you're trying to add a feature, but then halfway through fixing that bug, you introduce 9 new bugs, as one does. Now you have a place to go back to. Now you have a very clear snapshot of your project that you can return to, and it's a point where you know that everything works. And so it's a safety net in case anything goes wrong in the development process. Additionally, now you can keep track of your changes and you can have a kind of log of what has gone on in this project throughout its lifetime instead of just having the end final product. Now you can also avoid this rather common case where you think that you have something completed and you name the file, let's say final, right? And then you realize 2 minutes later, oh no, I need to make some changes. So you make some edits to it and then you save it again as final. And then you realize 3 minutes later, oh no, I have to make another change. And then you save it again and so on and so forth until you just have this mess of files that are all named some version of final with more and more intensity and you don't know which one's the actual final file. So with version control, you can fix all of this. Everything is just in a single timeline. And so your final version of everything is just that. It's the final thing at the very end. Finally, and possibly the most important use case for version control is collaboration. And I say most important because this is, after all, a hackathon. You're going to need to collaborate with people. So just as version control allows you to be able to look at all the versions that you have, be able to go back to different versions, be able to add new versions, it allows other people to do the same thing. And other people can also see the entire version history of your project and add new changes and contribute.
Now we'll start talking about Git and GitHub. And you might have heard of Git or GitHub, and these two terms are used very interchangeably quite often, but they're actually two different things. So Git is the version control system. This is what tracks the changes that you make over time. GitHub is the company that hosts your Git repositories. And a repository is similar to a directory, but instead of storing all of your data multiple times, it'll keep track of the changes that you've made and the steps necessary to reproduce those kind of changes. And of course, there are always many alternatives to Git, but in terms of version control systems, Git is by far the most popular one out there, which is why we're introducing it to you guys today. And the same goes for GitHub. So GitHub is the most popular platform for hosting Git repositories, where it provides issue trackers and code review tools to help you with your projects or your team projects. And you can always share your code and collaborate with other people.
All right, so at this point, you guys should have a fairly good understanding of what Git is and why we might want to use it in our workflow. So now let's dig into more of the how. And so I'm going to start by giving a quick crash course in the conceptual layout of Git and how it works and how you would incorporate it into your own workflow. And then Saki's going to go and give you a more concrete example of this. So before we talk about anything with Git, let's just go over what a normal, well, I guess not normal, but a workflow without version control would be. So you should be pretty familiar with this. You just have your file that's stored on a computer, right? So you just have your local machine. And let's say this could be a Word document. This could be a text file. It could be code. It could be anything, right? And so let's just say we have that file. And now we just load it up from a computer, make our edits to it. And then when we're done with it, we save it. And then this cycle just continues over and over again. You just load the file up and you save it and you load it back up and you save it and you make edits until finally you have some kind of output, right? And so I'm just going to draw a little crown here to show that it is what we intend to be our final output. And of course, you can go back and edit this, but for all intents and purposes, this is our output of this process, right? And so this works for most applications, but there's a problem with this in that once you're done with this, you only have two points of entry to see the history of all this, right? You have your final product, and you have this kind of the trivial case, but you have the empty file that you started with because it is empty, and so you know that was there. You basically lose all of this intermediate information, right? You lose the exact changes that you made on Tuesday if today is Friday, right? Or on Wednesday. You lose all that information, so you don't, let's say you have some change that you made on Wednesday, and you decide that was a good change. I like that change, but on Thursday, I decided to get rid of it, and now that I have my final product, I wish I really had that access to that change. I really wish I had that. I was able to, like, I would be able to go back in time and grab that change and bring it back because I don't have access to it anymore. And so that is the main problem with this workflow that we are trying to solve with version control. And so now let's introduce version control. So how would we incorporate version control into this workflow? So you have your computer, right? And then let's do three files this time, just because there's something that makes more sense if we have more files in this project. So we have a directory, right? And let's say this is our little programming project. We have three different files in our programming project. And so we load all of them up, right? So you make three new files, you make edits to them, and then you're still saving them to your computer. But instead of just having this cycle up here, what you're going to do differently is now, if we want to save this point in time, if we want to basically have a checkpoint, right? If we want to have a checkpoint to this point in time, a save point, what we can do is we can do just that. With version control, you can basically take a snapshot of this point in history and load it into this point on some timeline. And this timeline basically represents your Git history, right? Your version control history. And two steps were taken to do this thing. Firstly, what we did was, in order to save this point in history, we need to tell Git, because what Git is not doing, Git is not saving an entire copy of this file system for you to access later. So what I mean there is, it's not copying this file, this set of files, and saving them somewhere else. And then you can continue working the original files. You have a copy that's stored somewhere. That's not what this is doing. Instead, it's taking a snapshot of this current state, and it's making sure that it knows the changes that happened here. And so, let's say, first of all, it needs to know what changes were made. And so the way we do that is with staging. And this is going to be our first piece of terminology. Staging, and then synonymously, adding. Right? And so there's two terms here. Staging is more of the official term. This is what you're doing. Git add is the command that you're actually going to use. And so that's why there's two words here. I'm just going to clarify that it's just doing add, right? And so let's say, what I mean by that is, let's say, I can empty these files real quick. Let's say you made a change to this file, right? And you made another change to this file, and you made another change to this file. And really, we don't really even care about what we did in these files. All we need to know is that we made changes to this file right here. Right here. This is the file that we want. And these files, let's say that when we loaded this up, we only actually edited this file. Let's say we didn't even modify these files at all, right? And so Git doesn't need to know what happened to these files. Git only needs to know what happened to this file because this is where the interesting change happened. And so what you can do is you can tell Git, let's add this. So we're going to stage these files. And so now Git has, I'm just going to draw, it's kind of an abstract shape, but we're just going to draw a little platform right here. This platform is where the changes are. And so we can stage any number of changes. We can add any number of changes, And this is called the staging area. And once we are satisfied, we know that we are keeping track of all the changes that we want. We can then go and commit those changes. And so that is another piece of terminology right there, committing. So the word commit. And what committing is just this step right here. Committing is saving every change that you have in the staging area into this point in history. So now we've made an edit. We've staged that edit. We've put it into the staging area. And then we've committed that edit into the version control history. And now this process, we can just keep on going. I'm going to erase these words for now. I'll go back over them later in the workshop, or at least later in this part of the workshop. But I'm going to erase them for now just because I want to keep on drawing the rest of this workflow. And so to reiterate, we started from the computer. We make new files. We only modified really this one. And so we stage this change. And now it is in our version control history. We save this exact file, this set of files to our computer. And now this process right here, of saving, this is where the actual meat of it happens, right? This is where the content of the file is actually stored and the way that's handled. This right here, this committing part, this is just taking a snapshot. It's not necessarily storing all this information. It's just saying, here are the changes that happened, and I'm going to keep track of those changes here. And now, the next time you edit, you're going to load them up, and let's say you make some changes. This file stays the same, but now we have these files that you made changes to. And now we don't really care about this file right here, number one, because no changes happened. So Git, we can add these files right here. Tell Git, I want to keep track of these changes now. Put them into the staging area. And now commit them into this point in time. And so then this process keeps on going on and on and on. And then we have more and more and more and more and more nodes, basically, or like snapshots in this timeline. And then at any point in time, right? So let's say the equivalent of this guy right here. We have a file, or in this case, three files. So we have three files, right? And this is our de facto final product, right? Now, we not only have access to this final product and the starting point, the trivial case, basically, we also have access to any one of these save points. So now, going back to that example, right? On Tuesday, you made that change, or I guess I said Wednesday. On Wednesday? Tuesday? On Wednesday. You made that change, right? Today's Friday. On Wednesday, you made that change. You want to go back and grab that change. Now, instead of being lost and without any hope, you can go back and say, here was the commit that I made that saves those changes. And so then, version control will basically allow you to go back and take a look at what happened at this point in time. So that is what version control would do for you in your regular workflow. So now, that is version control in the context of just you and your local machine. Let's introduce another piece. And this piece is now going to be the idea of GitHub, right? And we talked about GitHub. GitHub is the place on the internet for you to store your Git repositories. Again, there are multiple alternatives. GitHub is going to be the one that we are covering. And so, again, it is where you can store your local Git repositories. Now, there are two ways you can go about starting a version-controlled project. Number one is you can start with this workflow. You can just make your own project on your local machine and then keep on working. And then at some point, if you want to upload it, you want to keep track of it on the cloud, you can do that. Or you can start it in GitHub and then from there, copy it down to your local machine. And so now we have a new set of commands that we need to learn in order to interface our local Git timeline with the one in the cloud. And the way we interface with it, and I'm just going to go through the latter option of doing this, that is we start from GitHub instead of starting locally. If we start from GitHub, what we can do is we now have a timeline that is on GitHub, right? And let's say we have our initial commit, which is we just started everything, right? So now we want to bring this timeline down to our local machine. What we can do is we can use this new piece of terminology, clone. And what cloning is basically, it's saying here is a copy of that timeline. And it's not just a copy. You're not just downloading something from the internet, right? This is not like they just made a copy and these two don't care about each other. These two actually do care about each other. And what you can basically do is these two are linked. These two are now linked. You can sync these two up with each other. And the reason we want that is because, let's say you cloned this repository up here down to your local machine, and then you did this workflow up here, right? This local Git workflow. And then you created all of these new timelines, or not timelines, these new snapshots in history. And now you are out of sync with what is on GitHub, right? Because you have a lot more information here now. And you want this to not be the case, because otherwise, if they're out of sync, the repo on GitHub is not really relevant. So we want to sync them up. And the way we do that is by pushing. And what pushing is, it's easy to think about it as basically just uploading your changes. But again, we want to make a distinction between simply making a copy of our information and keeping track of the changes. What pushing is it takes this timeline, all the changes that happened, not exactly the code that was written. It doesn't exactly take all the code and basically, it's not the equivalent of storing stuff somewhere. While effectively it does this a lot of the time, what it's really doing, what it's trying to do is keep track of changes. And so you're pushing this timeline now. And now when you push, the entire timeline exists in GitHub. You're now synced together. So syncing up is the keyword here. And so you've been able to push to your timeline. But now, let's say a change happened on GitHub. Let's say you were working from a different computer that was also had this project cloned, right? And this is an important part, because GitHub facilitates collaboration, let's say someone else someone else cloned your repository and then pushed it, and they synced up with GitHub, and now they have changes on GitHub. So now GitHub has this guy's changes. So I'm going to put a little star here to say that this is new. GitHub has these changes and you do not. What you can do is pull. And so now pushing and pulling, these are two sides of the same coin, right? Pushing just means that you sync GitHub with what you had on your local repository, and pulling means you sync your local repository with what was on GitHub. Pretty simple. And then everything else, you keep this basic workflow up here. I am going to cover my entire workspace in arrows, but basically GitHub is now just a place where you can sync up this workflow right here with something somewhere on the internet. So you can sync that up, you can keep track of it, other people can access it, and it facilitates both collaboration, and it just basically it allows you to keep your version control history off of your own local machine. Now, let's backtrack a little bit before we go to the last part. And so I'm going to backtrack a little bit back to this workflow right here. So let's say that you're going through this workflow, right? But let's say we're working on an app, okay? And so let's say that at this point in your app, you have somewhat of a finished product, right? You have something that works. Everything kind of works. There's a few bugs here and there, but you could theoretically deploy this and someone could use this. Let's say that's your current scenario, right? But let's say you have a bug. You have a bug and you want to fix this bug. Or alternatively, you have a feature that you want to implement. However, the problem is that by implementing that feature, before you get that feature done, you are going to put in code that might break this current product, right? And so once you have that feature done, or once you fix that bug, everything is great. You've accomplished your goal. But in the meantime, all those intermediate commits that you might have made would have... So let's say if we were to continue this workflow, right? Let's say that down here, this is the commit where you fix everything. At any point in here, right? These guys are all things that would have broken the code. And so we don't want that, right? We don't want to have it such that you are, let's say, at this point in time, where you are halfway done with completing the bug fix, but you have, in doing so, broken whatever you had here. And so we don't want that to happen. We don't want to have the intermediate steps break the current code. And so what we can do is we can kind of like create an alternate timeline. And so the idea here is we're going to introduce a new piece of terminology. We're not going to call it, it's already named, branching. So branch. And so With branches, you basically have multiple, it's kind of redundant, but you have multiple branches of the same code. And so let's say we want to create a branch just so we can work on some other feature. We're going to call this main branch is going to be just the main branch, right? We're going to call this one, let's say, feature. So we want to implement a feature here. We can also have another branch somewhere where we basically branch off and we call this bug because we want to fix this bug. And so you can have any number of branches, and each branch, the goal of that branch serves a purpose. That branch is for you to implement a change without breaking the current state of things. All right, and so with this, with this idea of branches, we can basically keep this main branch untouched, right? So at this point, we can just go back to this main branch, and this is going to be the latest thing we have, right? So I'm just going to demonstrate. This might get a little bit confusing if everything's already here. But let's say that none of this exists yet, right? And we want this point right here. We want this point to be the latest thing we have in the main branch. We can then branch off and then have all these different features down here. And I'm just going to erase this for now just because it might be confusing to have multiple branches for now. But we can implement all of these guys, right, in this new branch. And then once we're done with that, we can hook back up into our main branch, right, in our primary timeline. And now we can link all of these changes up. And we've basically made the jump from one stable point to another stable point, and all these intermediate unstable points, these guys never touched here, never influenced this stable point right here. We hid these away until they were complete, and then we arrived at this completed product. And so that is basically the purpose of branches. And then we're going to introduce another piece of terminology, which is called checkout. And with checkout, simply it is you are hopping between branches. So if you're on your main branch, you can check out your feature branch. If you're on your feature branch, you can go and check out your main branch. So now let's go into the final portion of this, and that is working with someone else's repository. So let's consider the example of TensorFlow. I mentioned that TensorFlow is one of the more prominent open source projects out there. It is located on GitHub. You can go on GitHub right now, search up TensorFlow, and you can clone the entire repository into your local machine and go and play around with it, do whatever you want with it. All the code is there. So if we treat this like workflow number three, we can do most of it. We can replicate workflow number three most of the way. And I mean by that, we can clone the repository into our local machine, right? So we have a timeline of TensorFlow with a lot of nodes because it's a big project. And we can clone it to our local machine. And with every change that happens in TensorFlow, if someone else makes a new push, if some of the maintainers make new changes, you can then pull those changes. The one part that we're missing right now, though, is pushing. We can't directly push to TensorFlow for obvious reasons, because you don't want just anyone making any change to your very important project that everyone is using, right? A lot of people are using TensorFlow. You don't want just anyone to make a change. And so this part right now, for now, is off limits. We can't do this part. How do we work around this? Because we do want to be able to contribute to TensorFlow, right? Otherwise, what's the point of having it be open source? And so what we can do is, instead of having this workflow, what we can do is introduce a new mechanic, and we're going to call this mechanic forking. What forking is, it's basically you take the repository and you make a copy of it onto your own personal GitHub. From there, fork. From this repository, right, you can then do all of this fun stuff, right? Because this basically this is now workflow number three. You can clone it to your local machine, make all your changes, push and pull, right? So now everything basically just, you have a copy of TensorFlow, and this is really just a true copy. Nothing that you do actually pertains to TensorFlow. Because if you can make any changes you want, you can push all you want, it's not going to affect what's going on in TensorFlow. Unless unless you do this thing. And so we do want to eventually be able to contribute back to TensorFlow, right? The way we do that is by saying, let's say, so an example, TensorFlow has a bug. Let's say we notice a bug, we want to fix that bug. We fork TensorFlow over to our personal GitHub. We make changes. We keep on doing this until we fix the bug. And now bug fix is located in our own personal GitHub. We want this bug fix to be reflected in the original repository of TensorFlow. So what we can do is we can request that the maintainers of TensorFlow pull in our changes. And as it is aptly named, we can make a pull request. Now this, again, is basically you're saying, I have a change. I want this change to be reflected in the original repository. I want you, the maintainer of the original repository, to pull my changes in. I'm requesting that you do it. I'm making a pull request. So now we have forking and pull requesting as two sides of the same coin, in the same way that pushing and pulling are the two sides of the same coin. So now we have, basically, we have a very, not exactly complicated, but we have a very in-depth and robust workflow that we can work with that allows us to both contribute to, we can contribute to big open source projects. We can also keep it as small scale as just simply keeping track of our own changes as we make a personal project. And so version control really is a very useful tool in this way. And so now that I have really gone through and given you guys a deep dive on the conceptual side of things, let's go and take a look at what this would look like in a concrete example. So I'm going to hand things back over to Saki.
Okay, so now that Sam went through all the commands, let's do a quick walkthrough as an example on how to use all of these commands. So I have our Vandy Hacks repository opened over here. It's also github.com/vandyhacks/open-source-rex-hackpack. So the first thing we're going to do is to fork this repository so that I have my own copy of this repository. And you can do that by clicking on the fork button on the right side here. Simply click it and I'll fork it to my account, which is Hockey Home. It's going to take a second. Move this really quick. All right, so now you can see that now we're in my account and I have successfully forked the open source rex-r hackpack. So now I'm going to clone this repository so that I have a version of this on my local machine. So how I'm going to do that is I will click on this green button and press this copy, or I'll just copy this link and I will open my command prompt. And if you have a Mac or a Linux, make sure to open your terminal. And right now I'm in my user folder, so I'll do a quick CD and I'll go to my desktop and simply use the git clone command and then paste that link to my repository and click enter. And you can see that it's successfully cloned onto my machine. So let me go to my desktop and it's right here. And you can see that I have copied all of my files over. So the code editor that I'll be using in this workshop is Visual Studio Code. And if I just open the folder that I just cloned, let me go find it. So I'm in desktop, open source Rex, select folder. It'll open all of those files for me. And let me just go to the README file. Actually, let me go to the HTML file, my bad. All right, so we're going to do a quick change and we're going to go through all of the git, add, commit, push commands really quick. So before I do that, I'm going to open the terminal and make sure that I'm on the right branch. So there are two ways that you can do it. On Visual Studio Code, you can always look at the left bottom side corner and you can see that I'm on the master branch. But also, you could do, you can use the command git branch to check what branch you're in. And right now I'm a master, so that's good. If I wanted to change my branch, like Sam said, you can always use the git checkout command and then type in the branch that you want to move into. But right now I want to stick with master, so I'm going to do that. And so Let me make a quick change on this HTML file. So the title says Chrome Easter Egg Happy Penguins, but what if I don't like penguins and I like lions? Then I'll make that change, Happy Lions, do a save. And you can always see, you can see that on the left, it says M for modified. So now that I made a change on my local machine, so usually this would be like fixing a bug or something. So let's say that I just fixed a bug by saying Happy Lions. So now I will do a git add so that, oh, let me do a git add and the, I'll add in the file that I just edited. So I just edited index.html. So I'll add that file. And then I will commit that change and say change the title. And it'll say that one file has been changed. I made one insertion, one deletion because I modified one line. And now that I have committed, I will do a git push. And this will sync my local changes to the online repository. And that's it. It's as simple as that. So now if I go back to the online repository, if I refresh, you can see that my commit right here has been pushed. It says change the title. And if you go see, the file has been successfully changed. So now that I have finished changing my my repository, I'm going to make a pull request. And the button for that, because it says this branch has one commit and head of Vandy Hacks master, I'll go ahead and request a pull request. So let me just create my pull request. And so he changed the title. So I'm just making a quick comment here on what I changed, and you can, it's as simple as just clicking that green button right there. So I'll do that. And it says there's no conflicts, and anybody else, whoever's the administrator of the Vandy Hacks repository will be able to merge the pull request. So I will come back to here. So just as a recap of what we just did, first of all, you would always read the README file to kind of get an idea of what that repository has code about. And the first thing that we did was to fork the repository from the Vandy Hacks account, which is obtaining a personal copy of the repository. And then we did a quick git clone so that we can have that repository on my local machine. We made a change. We changed from Happy Penguins to Happy Lions. So we changed the title of the tab. And then we did a git add, which staged the file into the editing area. And then we did a git commit with the comment. And then we git pushed all of those changes so that that can sync everything up together. And the last thing is that we did is we went back to GitHub to see that the commit has been successfully pushed. And then we did a pull request.
All right. So that was our open source workshop. And so thank you for attending. Thank you for coming and watching. And we hope that you were able to get something out of this. And hopefully now, if you weren't familiar with version control, GitHub, and Git before, now you have a place to start. And now you have a basic understanding of it. And this will hopefully enable you to now be able to collaborate with your team in building something awesome in this Vandy Hacks. So thank you and goodbye.